We have been under the boot heel of the oligarchs for thousands of years. And we really don't know what a real spiritual life is. We just can't develop it in a culture that has been so infested with propaganda. You know, what we need to do is to free ourselves of false narratives and then step into the future honestly and with our own reason, our own facilities, our own logic, and then try to develop a real spirituality. Ryan, I don't think it's actually been created yet. I think that that's all work to do in the future, but we need to get free of the false narratives and all of this weaponized crap that keeps us from thinking clearly. Because until we get there, we're not going to develop any spirituality that is really of the highest level, you know, or even a good level for ourselves.
Yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, I am Ryan Peverly, and you are listening to the Occulture Podcast, where a Coen Brothers film just isn't the same now. You just heard from our guest this time around, Joe Atwill. He is in the house to talk about his work on typology and weaponized anthropology, which focuses on the crucial fiction known as the New Testament, as well as the works of Shakespeare, J.D. Salinger, Ken Kesey, George Orwell, and more. Joe has a new book forthcoming called The Secret Language of Oligarchs, and this is hopefully part one of a two-part series that will lay the foundation for what is a thought-provoking journey behind the curtain that reveals a symbolic framework employed by scribes throughout history. There's about a 20 to 25 minute Patreon extension with Joe. More on that after the chat, which will provide you with a healthy dose of skepticism, conspiracy, and questioning of authorities. So wipe your feet on this rhythm rug and let's kick it with the one and only Joe Atwill. Enjoy. All right, Joe Atwill. Thanks for your time, man. Really appreciate you being here.
Hey, it's my pleasure, Ryan. Thanks for having me.
No problem, man. So you published two books with a third on the way, and actually reached out to talk about that third one, which is not out yet, but you were willing to do a two-part series here, and I guess it was your idea, and I'm grateful that you suggested that. We'll get to the books in a moment, but before we do, let's talk about you. I've heard you speak on other podcasts for years now, and I'd call you one of the more well-spoken and well-researched and maybe even controversial at times scholars or alternative scholars out there today, but I am curious how you came to be doing the work that you're doing. So if you don't mind, please give the audience who doesn't know you so well the Cliff Notes version of how you got here.
Well, it started with just a hobby I developed, probably that stemmed from my childhood education. I grew up in Japan. It was after World War II. I went to a Catholic boarding school, St. Mary's Military Academy, and I just became fascinated by the story of Jesus, frankly. As I got older, I sort of fell away from the faith. I didn't really have any epiphany about it. It just stopped being relevant to me. But I always was curious about the character. And I had some time in the late 80s because I had been involved with a software company, which we sold, or I was able to sell my share of it. So I had a period of time where I had I could do research. And I was doing research into the character Jesus Christ. I was just interested in this character as a historical being. I wasn't sure if he had been a divine person, of course. I didn't believe really in Christianity at that point. But anyway, I started reading Josephus's Wars of the Jews because this is the only book that really describes the first century in Judea. It's the only real history we have. And I just wanted to get a more focused, grounded understanding of the basis for the Jesus character in the Gospels. And in doing reading into Josephus, I started noticing very strange relationships between events Josephus was talking about in the war and the events that were described in the life of Jesus Christ. And so as the research went on, I just started to develop a theory about sort of the nature of the Gospels. We can talk about it later, but just as to how I got to where I am now, basically, sort of understanding the Gospels, I came to understand them as a typology, you know, which is just a fancy word, meaning that they were based on another story, that the story we have of Jesus Christ is based on another story, the story of the military campaign of the Flavians in Judea. And so with that insight, I was able basically to see that other authors had shared this. And specifically, the one I wrote the next book on was Shakespeare. And I felt that the Shakespearean literature was actually completely involved in this typologic level of the Gospels. And so when, you know, you get Hamlet or Titus Andronicus, you know, the stories are sort of incoherent. A lot of the passages are regarded as what's called puzzle passages. They just make no sense to scholars. They're not really sure what the author of the Shakespearean literature had in mind, but they made sense to me because I believe that the author was actually relating back to this understanding of the Gospels I developed. Well, the bottom line is that when you look at the Gospels or the Shakespearean literature, you're really looking at a struggle, a military struggle, a battle between different oligarch groups. And so I then was asked about, because I developed I had been writing about Christianity as mind control. And I pointed out that Constantine, who had made Christianity the state religion, he clearly understood Christianity as just something that he could use as a way to get the people he was going to enslave into the feudal system. And Constantine was the person who started to develop what we know as the feudal system. That if he could get them to believe in the character Jesus as divine, and that the Pope as the representative of God on the earth, that the slave system would work a lot more efficiently, because there would be less rebellion if you thought that God himself had deemed you as a slave. So I was asked about Neo-Christianity, which is basically the Christianity that, you know, uses channeling. It was developed in a book called A Course in Miracles by two authors, Thetford and Schuckman. And I was asked what I thought about it. If I thought that there was some, if it was parallel in any way to the mind control use of the original version of Christianity. And I really wasn't familiar with this variant of the religion, but I started studying it. And I noticed a very strange thing, that both of the individuals who were authors of the Course in Miracles had been, well, first of all, that they were scientists, that they were psychometricians, psychologists, which is an odd background to be, you know, they were claiming that Jesus was speaking through this one individual, Helen Schuckman. And so when I looked in their backgrounds, I thought that they'd both been part of what was called MK Ultra, which was a CIA basically, you know, project to study mind control. And so because I had the background of, you know, thinking of Christianity as mind control and something that the government was using to make a slave system, you know, easier to control, I was very suspicious of that relationship between the authors of A Course in Miracles and MK Ultra. Because when I looked into MK Ultra, I saw that this was basically just a technologic, you know, science to learn how to enslave people. And so as I started to have mind control, and so when I started to study MK Ultra, I could see it was pretty clear to me that there were other authors that were involved in this awareness of this modern slave state that Neo-Christianity would be part of, and that MK Ultra had been, you know, some science that they were developing in order to establish a static, stable, technologic slavery. And so I started to warn people about this. I went public, and I produced some literature on Ken Kesey, on the Grateful Dead, on J.D. Salinger, and these were elements that ended up in the new book that I'm publishing, which is strictly about the modern authors and how The literature is in the same way that the Shakespearean literature and the New Testament had been reflective of basically oligarchic slave systems, and the, you know, the literature was basically legacy. So and it was vanity, but it was also part of the way that the public was going to be controlled. And so I started to go public with this, and then, you know, basically as I started doing broadcasts and I published some of the literature. And from that point, it just sort of, you know, many people would come to me and ask for my opinions about different things. A lot of them, I wouldn't really have one, but, you know, over time, I've sort of developed just a general theory of how modern culture works and how it is basically an attempt by a group to create a technologic slave state. And I think that the best description of where we're headed is found in Huxley's Brave New World, where he describes a culture that only the government produces the beings, and there's very strict intellectual stratification. You know, you have delta and epsilons, you know, that do menial tasks, and then above you have these controllers who have high intelligence. And, you know, one of the more controversial things that I've been trying to get people to be aware of is that when you look at the skyrocketing autism rates, that I don't think that this is accidental or just the result of, you know, technology unfolding and creating pollution. I think you're actually looking at the real-time development of the delta and epsilon class. And so you can see that, you know, where I'm at is a controversial point. I'm very confident in my position, unfortunately, and I am basically trying to alert people that they need to try to have a more, you know, a quality of democracy that's higher than the one we have now, because basically there aren't any democratic choices that are being given to us, that the organization that is heading toward control over the world, basically, you know, they control both sides of the political dialectic. They give you Hillary or Trump. You hate Hillary or you hate Trump, and therefore there's drama, care about the result, but it really doesn't matter. You're going to have the same control over the banking system, the same control over the military, the same foreign policy, the same development of technological slave state, regardless of which one you elect. And so that's another, you know, point that I always try to make, is that the quality of our democracy is miserable, and that's something that people really need to basically try to move in a new direction. We just can't trust the process and the individuals, the media, that are producing the candidates that we have. We have to find a different way to vet individuals, to find people who will actually represent us.
Yeah, I don't think anyone listening would disagree with the crux of your statement there. And I'd like to go back to the typology for just a moment.
Sure.
Because as we work through Caesar's Messiah and maybe some Shakespeare and some Catcher in the Rye stuff too, this is the through line that runs through these books that you've written and some of the other articles that you've penned about these subjects. And you do call typology the secret language of the oligarchs, which is also the title of your next book. And I was just wondering, yes, if you could just maybe further define what typology is, like how you were able to recognize it in the work itself, because I don't think people listening would be as familiar with that.
That's absolutely correct. And it's a sad thing. And I hope that if there's anything that my work can do that's useful, it would be to make people aware of the typologic genre, because this is the way that the oligarchs communicate to one another. It's the way they create legacy. It's the way they ridicule the public. And it's a portal. It's a way we can understand what's actually happening to us. In Caesar's Messiah, I show that there's a very simple typologic system. It's the very beginning, very first page of the Gospels. And, you know, it's the famous story of Jesus Christ, where Joseph goes to Egypt, Herod then massacres boys. Joseph and Mary and the baby end up in Egypt, and then an angel appears and says, you know, they are dead, which sought the young child's life. The family returns from Egypt to Israel. At this point, there's a baptism. Jesus passes through water. He goes out into the wilderness for 40 days, and then you have the three temptations where he is tempted by bread. He tells the Satan, you know, in another episode, do not tempt God. And then finally he tells Satan, worship only God. So that's the pre-ministry, the pre-adult ministry of Jesus. And most Christians and a lot of people just familiar with the story of Jesus know that, and they know this. This is a story that is sort of iconic. Most people in our culture have some understanding of that. But what very few people have is that the story is demonstrably fiction, okay? And it is typologic. In other words, the author of Matthew is not trying to record the history of a character, Jesus Christ. Rather, he's writing a fictional story based on another story. This is typology. Okay, so the story that Matthew used is the story found in the Old Testament. And now in that story, you know, you start out with the character Joseph going to Egypt as you begin the story of, you know, in Matthew. Then you have Pharaoh massacring the boys. Then in Exodus 4, you have a verbatim statement, all the men are dead which sought thy life, which is repeated in Matthew 2:20. Then you return from Egypt to Israel, just like Jesus and Joseph do in Matthew. Then you have the baptism passing through waters, the whole Israelites, you know, the entire nation goes through water. But Jesus in Matthew 3:13, he is designated as the nation of Israel. There's a way, it's kind of complicated, I won't bother with it, but it's just, you can see that there's a passing through water. Now you go into the wilderness for 40 years. Now notice it's different, right? You have 40 years in Exodus where it's 40 days in the New Testament. Typology is never verbatim. It's just enough information is being used from one story so that an alert reader can easily see that the other story is related to it. The genre was used in Hebraic literature. In the Dead Sea Scrolls, you have a number of examples where you have these kind of relationships between prior prophets and the present time. In that literature, they're looking for patterns to see when a Messiah will appear. In the New Testament, they're just designating Jesus as the new Moses. He's going to be, whereas Moses had the old covenant, Jesus will represent the new covenant. So he has this relationship to Moses. Jesus goes into the wilderness for 40 days, whereas, you know, Moses takes the Israelites into the wilderness for 40 years. But then you have the temptations, the tempted by bread, the statement, do not tempt God, and the instruction to worship only God. And these are verbatim. I mean, the statements from the Old Testament are reused by Matthew. So the story in Matthew is based upon and is directly related to and basically is creating a way of understanding the character of Jesus using this prior story. So this is typology. And that little system of parallel names, locations, concepts, and also sequence, because sequence is extremely important. Notice that in Matthew, the events occur in the same order as they do in the Old Testament. So that helps an alert reader, you know, realize what they're seeing when they read the story in Matthew. So this little system, not very difficult to understand, is absolutely key to understanding basically our entire system of literature, unfortunately. I mean, this goes all the way from the Gospels into the Shakespearean literature and then reappears in the modern authors, people like Salinger, Ken Kesey. They will reuse the system so that they can create meaning that is amusing to an inside group, right, or someone who's sort of, you know, just aware of it, but is not visible to the public. So this system of typology is just critical for people to understand. And, you know, I hope that, as I said, that if there's any value to my work, I hope that just getting more and more people to understand that it is very easy to create a level using typology that the common person cannot understand. And once they do understand the literature, then they're simply a lot, they're more alert, they're harder to fool, and the literature I think can then be used to expose the truth of the political system that we're facing. So that's typology in a nutshell.
So besides all the works and the names that you've dropped already, are there any other examples of typology that people might know about, you know, like aside from Catcher in the Rye or Ken Kesey's work or Brave New World or things like that? Is there anything else that you've come across that people might think, well, shit, that's typology? That reflects this, you know, same, I guess, message that the Gospels are putting out there?
Well, it's not the same message. It's the same framework, the same symbolic framework. Well, I mean, unfortunately, our modern culture is just completely infected with this genre. Yeah, I mean, in the new book, I'll try to go through a lot of these things. But I mean, for example, the Coen brothers, you know, they link to this in many of their films. You know, in Oh Brother, Where Art Thou is basically a typology of the three Flavians, Vespasian, Titus, and Domitian. And they're often making comments about this literature. And I would just say that one source of modern typology would be modern Freemasonry. One of the ways that, or one of the secrets that it has, is an understanding of the typology in the Gospels. I think it's something, I mean, and I'm not a Freemason, I've never been in communication with people who are telling this, but I can deduce and infer quite a bit. And I'm very certain that at the higher levels, this is something that they give. It's part of the secret that they give. And when they talk about a new world order, basically what the target of that is the Christian world. The Freemasons would be at this high level dedicated to the destruction of Christianity and Christians in general, because they're basically taking the position that the literature is false, and they are entitled to basically, you know, destroy that world order and replace it with their own. And so, you know, it's like, I think you've read my analysis of Catcher in the Rye. I mean, it shows that J.D. Salinger, was his understanding of the levels of Freemasonry and how they are related to the apocalypse. I mean, just as a real quick example, I mean, you look at the title Catcher in the Rye. You know, what does that expression actually mean? It, you know, it comes from a deliberate misunderstanding of Robert Burns' song, poem, but it also indicates the Grim Reaper. And Salinger's actually talking about an apocalypse of, you know, someone who is, you know, going to kill and destroy. And, you know, then if you start to understand how he's developing this, and when I decoded Catcher in the Rye, a lot of the things are very subtle, sort of, if you're not looking for them, you wouldn't notice it. But there are other things which are really, it's disappointing that, you know, modern readers don't pick up on this stuff. I mean, at the very beginning, Salinger, his character Holden Caulfield, is, you know, has to study the Egyptians for 28 days and take a test. Well, you know, just a glance at Freemasonry shows that the first level occurs 28 days, and basically the ancient Egyptians would be something that, you know, could be easily seen as a representation of the information about the primitive level of Freemasonry. So it's right off the bat, you would wonder if Salinger's linking to this. And then just a few pages later, he talks about, you know, he's going to be sleeping in Eli's bed, and he repeats the expression, like, I think four times, that Holden will have to sleep in Eli's bed. He's knocked over, right? He's hoodwinked, he's clothed, they can't see, he's knocked over, and then he has to sleep in Eli's bed. Well, this is a, you know, transparent representation of one of the initiation rites of a level of Freemasonry, which is based on the passage in the Old Testament where Joshua sleeps in Eli's bed. And Salinger repeats the expression four times, and this is, you know, the typologic language has, there's basically a system to it. There are techniques that you know, can look for. And one of them is repeating of an unusual expression over and over again. That's done to alert someone who's on the inside that to pay attention, try to understand the literature from a, you know, from a different perspective.
Yeah. And just to stick with Catcher in the Rye then, since you're on it, Holden Caulfield does exhibit knowledge of both the Gospels and Shakespeare throughout the story. What are some of the references to those works that you found while you were working through there?
Well, you know, it's because it's sort of incremental. I'll just give the example that he talks about the lunatic who's in the Gospels as being his favorite character in the Gospels. This would be Simon and John are the two lunatics, and he refers to him as his favorite character. Well, that is the story which I show in Caesar's Messiah is that these two individuals are essentially Masons. They are tectons. Josephus has a story which is related typologically to Jesus's description of the Masons or Simon and John, the devils. He doesn't actually even name them. He just refers to the demons of Gadara. And it's complicated, but it's not, to decode it really isn't, it's not rocket science once you understand the genre. But Josephus refers to these individuals, like the Simon and John who are represented in the Gospels. They reappear in Josephus's history. The real individuals are the leaders of the Messianic movement that the Romans waged war against. And at the end of the siege of Jerusalem, they're underneath Jerusalem and they're trying to burrow out. And Josephus refers to them as the tectons, which the word appears in the Gospels and is translated as carpenter, but this is not the correct translation. It's actually mason. And in fact, in modern Greek, the word tecton is simply the word for Freemasonry, tecton. And so when you understand that Salinger is representing the levels of Freemasonry, and then he talks about this individual as his most favorite character, the lunatic, you can see that, you know, it's just a way of clarifying Salinger is well aware, as the high-level Masons are in general, of the typology in the Gospels. It's a system of understanding that's incremental. If you understand this little typologic beginning of the Gospels, then you can make more sense and easier sense out of the rest of the complicated story of Jesus Christ. And it's when you stand back and look at all of the pattern that the whole thing suddenly is crystal clear. And this is sort of true with like the modern literature. It's, you know, because for one thing, Ryan, it's, you know, if I start talking about, well, you know, Catcher in the Rye is, you know, is a representation of Freemasonry, it's such a left field idea that, you know, there's just cognitive dissonance. People will just resist it. You have to actually bring them into the literature itself slowly and incrementally and show them, look, here's the very first level. Here's 28 days studying the Egyptian. Here's sleeping in Eli's bed. Here's where he's hoodwinked. You can actually get, you know, the understanding of Holden Caulfield as someone who is going to go to a very high level of Freemasonry. Caulfield, I mean, his name is representative of a messianic individual. Holden, which is more complicated, but Caulfield, a cough is just it's a membrane that one child, I think 10,000, is born with and is seen in folkloric tradition as representative of a, you know, someone who's destined for greatness. And Holden is described as being of great height, and he already has white hair, you know, so he's wise beyond his years. And so he's destined to go through and succeed. You know, at the end, unfortunately, you know, he has a strange experience with horses, which is linking to the Book of Revelation and the horses that appear during, you know, in the Book of Revelation, which leads to the apocalypse. And he's wearing his shooting hat, you know, which is, I explain, you know, that this is related to the Masonic cap. And so Salinger brings his character basically to a, you know, a bad end. It's where he's violent. You don't see it. It's not on the surface. You have to understand the Robert Burns poem that is misunderstood, and you have to understand this whole Freemasonic process inside the book. But the oligarchs like to make representation, and they, I think, somehow encourage writers and filmmakers to do this. And it's also a way of ridiculing the public, because that's another important part of the typology. The Roman typology in the Gospels ridicules the Jews, right? It makes the Jews basically eat human flesh. They have the flesh of the Messiah is something that Jesus talks about. It's a grisly subject, but Jesus flatly states, you know, this is my body, this is my blood. And people think he's talking symbolically. But it's only when you understand the typology, you get to see how vicious the humor is. Because if you are working through the story of the war that is related to Jesus's gospel, this is the analysis I do in Caesar's Messiah, you can see at that point in the narration, that point in the sequence, Josephus describes a son of Mary who is actually eaten. cannibalized. And so, you know, this provides the context for the story in the Gospels that you know, you don't see if you just read the surface narration, where it seems as though the character is speaking symbolically. But when you look at the literal cannibalism in Josephus, then it's transparent that this is, they are ridiculing basically the messianic family of the rebellious Jews as cannibalizing one another. So now another group appeared in the Middle Ages, and this then produced the Shakespearean literature. And so if you, you know, look at the play Titus Andronicus, I mean, it's a reversing of the vicious humor that the Romans expressed. And so in Titus Andronicus, you see that the author of the play is Jewish, and they are pretending to be a Gentile. The name even, Will Shakespeare, which is, you know, on the first folio, is just it's a pun. It just shows, you know, Will Shakespeare. It means that the Jewish authors of the Shakespearean literature are not cowed or destroyed by by Christianity, and they can come up with a response. And so in Titus Andronicus, and I won't, you know, go into the long analysis, but it's just reverses the story in the Gospels. You have, you know, a crucifixion, an insertion of someone from another, you know, ethnicity into a royal lineage. And then here Titus, you know, Titus Andronicus gets the Gentile nobility to eat human flesh. So this reverses the humor in the Gospels. The Shakespearean literature, I became interested in it just because of the character's name, Titus Andronicus, which is actually quite a clue. Titus Flavius, who was basically the central character of the story that the character Jesus Christ is based on, he sacked the Temple of Jerusalem. And Andronicus is one of the other individuals who did that. So Titus Andronicus combines the names of two individuals who sack the temple. And then this person has a terrible fate. And they, you know, the Shakespearean author chose the name deliberately. You know, he was actually making they were setting up this individual, Titus Andronicus, as a type to cast the fate to them in terms of their literature that the Romans had done to Jesus Christ. The Shakespearean literature as Jewish literature is not well understood, but it's just very surprising to me. I'll just give you like an example of the humor that pops up immediately when you start looking at the literature from the right perspective. In the play Macbeth, at the beginning of it, people are talking about the character Macbeth. And the one guy says, you know, noble Macbeth, well does he deserve his name? And then he describes his action on the battlefield where he unseamed and one of his opponent, you know, so noble Macbeth, well does he deserve his name? He unseamed an opponent. And then in the play Macbeth, there's all of these references to seamsters, to sewing, and no one has made any sense out of it. And this is shocking because it's an obvious pun. It's a Hebrew pun. The word Macbeth in Hebrew is seamster. So once you look at the Shakespearean literature as coming from basically these would be Murano or crypto Jews. And in London at this time, the Jews had been technically expelled from England. But, you know, there were Jews in existence. They found synagogues that were practicing Judaism in secret, and this would have been the group that produced the Shakespearean literature. And I identify the author as a language instructor, a woman named Amelia Bassano, and she wrote a poem called Hail God, King of the Jews, Salve Deus Rex Juordum. She was, you know, ostensibly a Christian, but they had to convert to Christianity in order to legally enter England. But she obviously had maintained her at least her Jewish perspective. And then when events in her life, you know, it's a long story, but she had reason to really dislike the royal family of Christianity, the British royal family. And so as a response to that, she came up with the Shakespearean literature. And then this literature then became basically a platform that other writers who can, you know, could use as a way of expressing derision and also use to create legacy for the group that was coming forward. In the book, The Secret Language of the Oligarchs, I actually focus primarily on Brave New World by Aldous Huxley. which has a Masonic level to it, just like, you know, Catcher in the Rye, but is also completely related to Shakespeare. Huxley is just absolutely conversant with the typologic level of both the Gospels and Shakespeare's. And I show dozens of examples of this in the work. In fact, Brave New World, you know, comes from The Tempest. And, you know, I show why this expression was used and then reused by other authors. You see, once you understand Huxley's use of it, then you can understand, for example, the expression used by Rudyard Kipling. He uses the expression and he uses it in the same way. And so really what I suggest is that many of the authors that have had cultural influence, Huxley and Kipling, Salinger, that actually they are reflecting this typology. They are aware of this struggle against Christianity. They are part of the struggle against it, and they create the literature to document that you know, they are engaged, and also to ridicule people who don't have the mental facilities to understand the world around them, which was the comic point that the Romans made. And so this is really what you're seeing, is it's Jewish authors, but not many ostensibly Jewish authors. It's primarily what I would call crypto Jews, like Huxley, Kipling. These are people, I believe, that actually see themselves as in some way, and I don't know if it's ethnic or intellectually, but related to, you know, the religion that was there before Christianity. And so they are linking in a way that is derisive to the Roman typology and to Christianity in general. The problem is that they have, you know, it's not just symbolic, in my opinion. I mean, they are literally trying to basically create a kind of world dictatorship through technology. And so we need to understand this group, you know, immediately and try to, you know, bring their perspective of the world and of humanity that they give in their literature to light, so that everyone can understand it and have a, you know, make some kind of democratic response to it. Because, you know, for thousands of years, the public basically has been on the outside. We see things like Christianity or the Shakespearean literature or, you know, the political system that we've been given, the United States of America, and it looks on its surface as though it's a republic. But when you start to look underneath and you start seeing the Masonic control of the creation of the president, for example, presidency, how many presidents have been either flat out Masons, suspected of Masonry, or in some related secret society like Skull and Bones, for example. I think the public really needs to do more, you know, investigation into this, because if you look at our last 200 years, you can see that, you know, we've just been in a genocide machine. You know, they talk often and with great cultural weight about, you know, the Holocaust of Jewish people during World War II. They use the number 6 million. But if you look at the number of Gentiles that died in that war, and also in wars since, you know, say Civil War, I mean, it's been hundreds of millions. And so, you know, is this just a failure of the political class? Well, unfortunately, when you start looking at the literature closely, you can see that not only is the political class not failing, you know, just spectacular, catastrophic blunder after blunder, things like World War I, the Civil War, but that really what you're seeing is that both sides of these struggles are controlled by the same group, and that population reduction is the goal. So this is a pretty grim insight, and, you know, it's one that I would really like to see considered by the public. And be aware, Ryan, the public is going to have to do this on their own. The media is a complete control device that is just there to, you know, distract us and to give us bad information.
Definitely, yeah, I would agree with that 100%. And, you know, back to the Shakespeare thing for just one moment, because I thought of a question while you were talking there, and I just want to throw it at you real quick. So the authorship has been debated, obviously, for a long time now. Do you think that that debate, you know, like pointing people to guys like Francis Bacon or even like John Dee, like, do you think that's just purposeful misdirection to keep people away from what you've been telling us about how maybe it was just a group of Jews that were writing here?
You know, I don't know. I think in some cases that could well be the case. But if you look at one of the people that I showed my work to and ended up writing a book about it is a Shakespearean scholar named John Hudson. And one of the things that John did was he simply created a knowledge map of the candidates for the Shakespearean authorship. You know, and you talk about Oxford or Bacon, Marlowe, you know, these individuals. And he pointed out that Emilia Bassano was really the only individual that had all of the information needed to write the literature. And yet she's never been considered as a candidate, even though as a woman she published the first copyrighted poem in the English language. And she used expressions that are completely parallel. I mean, like all the world's a stage is one of the expressions that she used. So it is just astonishing that, you know, people will first of all, they'll ignore the obvious Hebrew puns and then not try to find, you know, an author that whose knowledge map, the known points of information that we have about these individuals, links up to the author. So I don't know. I would say that they don't have to try really very hard to keep things hidden at this point, because it all starts with an understanding of the Gospels. And for 2,000 years, I mean, the you know, one thing, if you of the documentary that was made about Caesar's Messiah and reviews of people who've read the book, there are like thousands and thousands of reviews. And if you read, if you go through them, one thing that just comes up over and over again is people say, why haven't I ever seen this before? It's so obvious when you actually look at these parallels between Jesus and Titus. It's just so transparent. Why hasn't this ever been shown to me? And, you know, the oligarchs simply don't want the public to have this information. And so what they give us is other interpretive frameworks. And that's good enough to keep the population basically mentally numb. And so as far as, like, has Shakespeare been deliberately hidden? I think that it awareness of Shakespeare is obviously something that the high level of the secret society has. Okay, they all share this, but I don't think they really have to go very far to fool the public. What the public needs to do is to sort of understand typology from the beginning. I mean, that small story that I talked about, you know, with Matthew, you know, which is the pre-ministry of Jesus. Even though that it's a pretty humble story, it only has like 8, you know, links in it, and it's not difficult at all to understand. If you don't understand that, the whole literature that we have is going to be impossible really to get, because so much of it is written based on the typology that is found in that small story. So that would be the first step. And, you know, because I actually think it's like I've had, you know, many, many debates and discussions with people about both Shakespeare and you know, the Gospels. And it's just sort of astonishing of how often they have such strong cognitive dissonance. They are simply mentally frozen in place by their conditioning that even if you show things which are just completely transparent and obvious, they resist. They struggle against it because they don't want to revise any history. You know, I talk about the modern history quite a bit. And, you know, I think that that's just a good example of how easy it is to basically give people false narratives and have them buy it. As long as the public gives trust to the media, as long as, you know, CNN and Fox News and New York Times are seen as credible and not as engaging in propaganda to enslave, they can basically control and create the minds of the public. The kind of awakening is going on now, and it's occurring, you know, certainly not just in my work. I mean, you're talking about 10,000 people now are sort of aware that there is something wrong with both our history and our media. And everyone now is that is sort of in the alternative media is in one way or another engaged in trying to expose this. It's a huge schematic. I mean, there's thousands of different parts to this. You know, you have MK Ultra, you have the Freemasons, Bohemian Grove, you've got, you know, CBS, you know, and its relationship to the government. I mean, you can just go on and on. All of this is getting basically built out. The schematic that is reality, that exposes the whole cultural enslavement and intellectual enslavement that's been created, is going on, and part of it will be, you know, the stuff that I write about, but just one part of it.
Yeah, and you know, I can get down with the enslavement of people through religion. That idea, it makes a lot of sense, especially when you lay it out in Caesar's Messiah. And I wanted to go back to that real quick. I guess the point of the book of Caesar's Messiah is you sort of postulate that an imperial Roman family called the Flavians created the New Testament, which we've talked about. But tell us a little bit about who the key members of the Flavian family were, and you know, maybe more about their direct motivations for creating that text.
Yeah, and that's an important point, because I think that basically all readers can see that the story of Jesus is suspect if they just understand one key fact, which is that there was another messianic movement in Judea in the first century. It was militaristic. It drove the Romans out of Judea, and it set up a nation state, which Rome then attacked. And in the ensuing war, the war between the Romans and the Jews that went on between 66 and 73 CE, the events that Jesus prophesizes came to pass. In other words, Jesus talks about the destruction of the Galilean towns, Jerusalem's going to be encircled, Daniel's prophecy about the abomination of desolation will occur, the temple and the temple complex will be razed. Well, these events occurred during the war between 66 and 73. So you can see that the victors write history, and the Gospels are just a way of writing this, you know, military victory legacy, except it's written as a prophecy. And so that all of the events that Jesus envisions are Flavian military victories. All of his prophecies are basically about military victories that will occur from the Romans against the Jews, the Messianic movement that fought against them in the coming war. And I'll just give, you know, if people want to see just a very simple way of how directly linked Jesus's ministry is to the war, I'll just, you know, take a few seconds and point out that Jesus is seen to have been crucified on Passover 33. And there's a system in the Gospels that enables you to come up with that date. So this is how we have always dated the crucifixion, to Passover 33. Now, Jesus is, you know, given as the Passover lamb of the new covenant. This is a covenant that's going to replace the one that Moses had. In the first covenant, Moses has the Passover, and then he is wandering for 40 years. And at the end of the 40-year cycle, and 40 years is an important time unit in Hebraic literature, at the end of the 40 years, the old covenant, or what we call the Old Testament, will basically be fulfilled, and the Israelites will be given possession of the promised land. Moses doesn't get to go there, but the Israelites, after 40 years of wandering, they get ownership of the promised land. So Jesus is the Passover lamb of the new covenant. He is crucified on 33. This is the sacrifice of the human Passover lamb that is representing the beginning of this new religion and of the new covenant. The war between Romans and the Jews ends on Passover 73 with the fall of Masada. This is 40 years to the day from when the human Passover lamb began this process. So in other words, it is a perfect mirror of the old covenant. The human Passover lamb is, the sacrifice is created, and then exactly 40 years later, the Romans are now given control and ownership of the promised land. So this is basically the establishment of the new covenant or the New Testament. So this is an impossible relationship to be accidental. Whoever, you know, created the dates in the Gospels was well aware of the old covenant and was well aware that the war between the Romans and the Jews would end in that date. I mean, this obviously the chances of being circumstantial are like zero. So this shows you that the character Jesus Christ was created basically to be part of the representation of the Roman military victory. Now, the family that was basically fighting against the Messianic movement was the Flavians. They were a father and two sons, Vespasian, Titus, and Domitian, who are, you know, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost in Christianity. They actually make legacy about themselves in the Gospels. The family replaced the Julio-Claudians as Caesar. The Julio-Claudians, this particular family, had basically held the throne in Rome from Julius Caesar on through Nero, and the Flavians were military men. They were not in that lineage. The Julio-Claudians, according to the Flavians, had become decadent. You know, think of Caligula and Nero and the kind of lavish lifestyle. The Flavians felt that they were better equipped to run the empire because they came from the military. And so a coup occurred during the middle of the war. It occurred in 69. And at that point, the Flavians seized the throne. And then following the war, which concluded in 73, you had the creation of the Gospels. And this, in my opinion, this was when the Gospels, the original story of Jesus would have been written. And it would have been written in conjunction with the creation of the histories of Josephus. Josephus is the historian. He was a Flavian court historian. He had purportedly been with the Flavians through the whole war. He was someone who was claimed to be a high priest or a priest of Judaism. He converted. He had his epiphany where he realized that actually all of the messianic prophecies, and this is, it shows how obviously linked the literature is. Josephus came to the conclusion after a dream that, in fact, the messianic prophecies, which the Jews believe foresaw a Jew, actually foresaw the Flavian Caesar. And he had this dream before Vespasian had seized the throne, and he also threw in the prophecy that Vespasian would become Caesar. So this, you know, kind of basically established Josephus as a prophet. The Flavians picked him up as their religious, you know, liaison with the Jewish people. He tried to conduct, peaceful negotiations with them. And then after the war, Josephus wrote the official history of the war, which is the document that the Gospels were linked to. In other words, all of the stories that you find in the Gospels, if you go through them in sequence, you can see they are based upon the military campaign that Josephus described. And in Caesar's Messiah, in one of the chapters, I call it the Flavian signature. I just take one gospel, the Gospel of Luke, because I just wanted to lay one text against another. You can actually do it with Matthew and Mark, but it's more complicated because sometimes you have to first determine, what time is like a particular event occurring. So just for the point of clarity, I just lay the Gospel of Luke out next to Josephus, and I go through 40 experiences, and I show that the parallelism is transparent. If you look at the military campaign of Titus, it is in exactly the same geographical sequence and places and locations as occurs in the Gospels. And then you get, the events which are just transparent historical parallels. In other words, where Jesus is actually talking about a historical event, like the encircling of Jerusalem at the wall, that when you start to put the sequence together, that these events, which are just absolutely known as historical parallels between Jesus's prophecies and the Jewish Roman war, they are occurring in the same sequence and the same location. And then when you start then adding in the other, slightly more occulted symbolism of the different events, and you can see, at a certain point, you can see, wait a second, every single thing in the ministry of Jesus is basically based upon and is then in a way envisioning, right? Because typology is one of the aspects of it is that it can see into the future, supposedly, if you write it after the fact. It's basically a kind of a comedy that where Jesus is actually prophesizing all of these events that are going to occur in the Roman Jewish war. And Jesus is talking about, if you notice, he talks about the Son of Man who's going to come with all this destruction. You know, he dates this to the Roman Jewish war. I mean, he actually says, you know, when the temple is destroyed, Jerusalem encircled, the Son of Man's going to come, there'll be this terrible thing. This apocalypse, well, who is the individual he's talking about? It can only be the Flavian Caesar, because the Flavian Caesar actually came, did the events that Jesus envisioned, and established himself as the Jewish Messiah, or as Jesus would call him, the Son of Man. So, you know, the identity of Caesar in the Gospels is occulted. It's hard for people to see. No one has really, before Caesar's Messiah, made the case that the whole literature was created as a way of documenting Caesar as the Jewish Messiah. But once you actually break down the typology, it's transparent. And this is why, you know, Caesar's Messiah has had such an amazing success as a book. It has sold, I don't know, you know, just 100,000 copies with no, you know, advertising budget. I never attempt to advertise it. I only let the information spread word of mouth, because I think that's the best way for people to come, you know, to it. And it just continues to sell and sell and sell, because people read it, it makes sense, and then they tell other people, and then the book just keeps selling. There's also a documentary about it, which is available on YouTube. You don't even have to pay for it. It has quite a bit of the information in it. So that's the story of the Christian literature.
I think we should point out, too, that the only works that survived this century of religious warfare that you've been talking about were the Gospels and the histories of Josephus. And they both coincidentally present a pro-Roman perspective, do they not?
Absolutely. I mean, Jesus talks about giving to Caesar what is Caesar's. And bear in mind that the real Messianic movement, the one that rebelled from Rome, taxation was one of its key issues. It didn't want to pay the Roman tax. So when Jesus takes the position that the Jews should give to Caesar what is Caesar, he's clearly, you know, operating in a peculiar way for a son of David. If you think about the Jewish messiahs, they're warriors. They are xenophobic. They fight against people who come into Israel. Think of David cutting off Goliath's head. I mean, he is not asking people, you know, to turn the other cheek. In fact, you know, he's basically a xenophobic ethnic warrior. This would be the Messiah that would be legitimate. So when you see the Gospels with basically the Jews seem shown in a negative light, it's suspicious on its face. You know, you have to wonder, well, what's the political, is there a political purpose for that position? And then when you locate the literature in terms of the history, you can see, wait a second, this is very suspicious that it is a pro-Roman, you know, religion. One of the things that Jesus asks of his followers is when they're constricted to walk the extra mile. Now, this refers to the legal principle that any Roman soldier could have, you know, someone in the Roman Empire who wasn't in the military carry his pack for 1 mile. This is why they had things that are called milestones, so that at the end of the mile, the citizen could just put the pack down and then the soldier would have to carry from then on. But Jesus says, no, when you're constricted, walk an extra mile, not just one, but two. So you see, so this is subtly, you know, basically getting the population to accept the conditions of a dictatorship, of Caesar's control over them through the use of religion. And so then when you come to the history of Josephus, and he claims to be a Jewish priest, he claims to have been in the royal family. He had been a member of all of the sects of the Jews. He describes the three sects, and he says, I was a member of everyone. So he has this kind of authority to talk about matters Jewish that's, you know, almost impeccable. Then he, for some reason, has a dream where he realizes that God's favor, the covenant, is going over to the Romans, the new covenant. You know, and then he says, you know, these messianic prophecies that have caused so much trouble for the Jewish people, they caused them to rebel. We believe that God would send us a Messiah like David. You know what? We made a huge mistake. The messianic prophecies foresaw the Flavian Caesar. That's who the real Messiah is. And you see, this is not only suspicious, but in terms of literature, it's incredibly logical. Because if you look at the character in the gospel, the Son of Man, that Jesus is going to envision, that Jesus envisions going to come in 40 years, and then compare that character to Josephus' statement about the Roman Caesar being the Messiah, you can see that the literatures have exactly the same intellectual perspective, that Jesus is envisioning the head of an army coming and achieving all of these victories against the Jews. And Josephus is saying that the Roman Caesar is the Son of Man, is the Messiah. So, you know, as I said, once you start to really dig into the literature, the relationship between the two books, you can see that they're fused. They were created as part of one typologic system, one system of literature. And that relationship is not just, you know, kind of an academic curiosity, but if a reader gets familiar with it enough that it all makes sense, that those works make sense, then you can actually understand the modern era. Then you can understand what Huxley is writing about with Brave New World and Salinger, because there are Ken Kesey. You can see that these authors are actually, you know, building out from that basic, simple typologic system. And they're describing things in our modern world, which, you know, are basically in the same structure of politics that the Romans were, which is to say that they're describing, you know, an enslaved people. And that would be us, you know, the citizens of Europe and America.
Yeah, you know, I've seen the Bible labeled Roman propaganda before. I've also seen it labeled capitalist propaganda. And you mentioned at one point in the book that the New Testament presents tax collectors who would have been working for the Romans in a favorable light, and that the Apostle Matthew was actually described as a tax collector. That sounds like state propaganda, you know, respect sure. The tax man. You also point out a passage talking about people being subservient to judges and magistrates because they're doing God's work.
Sure. Once you kind of look at the literature just as political propaganda, just strip away the lens of religious history and just say, well, what was the function of this literature politically? It just isn't very complicated, Ryan. It's just a propaganda piece to get people to basically accept a role in a dictatorship, the role of basically, you know, subservience. And the trick that they found was that if you saw that your role in the world was ordained by a God you believed in, then the slave state was stable. You see, in order to achieve this, you had to trust in a divine person. And that's why, you know, the character Jesus Christ was developed and he was made the central character of the Roman state religion. I mean, it's just, if you think about it, politically, it makes no sense for Constantine, who wasn't a Christian, he had pagan religions that he was interested in, to make this religion the state religion. Why would you do that? It's because they saw the character Jesus Christ as so useful and believable as the head of what would basically be a slave state, the feudal system. I'll give you one little kind of comic tidbit about Constantine. When he died, he created a huge church. It's right next to Santa Sophia in Constantinople, which is, you know, now Istanbul. But he has this church, which his grave was created, and around it, he encircled his tomb with relics of the bodies of the 12 apostles. So, I mean, this is a pretty clear representation of who he thought was the head of the Christian church, right? That he's encircled himself with the 12 apostles. So you could see that, you know, to Constantine, when you think of the, you know, who is the Christ, who is the lead religious figure, it was him. And so when you think of the Pontiff Maximus, who is supposedly Jesus's representative, the Pope, the Pontiff Maximus is a term that was designated for Caesar. It described Caesar's role as the head of the Roman College of Priests. The Pontiff Maximus. This was Caesar. If you look at where the Vatican is now, it was where the Roman imperial palaces had been established originally. And so it's just, from a certain perspective, it's actually kind of ludicrous and funny, because in the Roman Catholic Church, Caesar didn't even give up his name. He just, instead of Caesar, he's referred to as the Pontiff Maximus. And instead of Caesar's palace, it became the Vatican. But it's simply one system of mental domination of all of the inhabitants of the Roman Empire.
Last question for you, Joe.
Sure.
What's your favorite Coen Brothers movie? And why is it Hail Caesar?
Well, it's just so transparent. It's Caesar, of course, is, you know, ridiculed. And there's a trilogy, actually. George Clooney referred to it as his numbskull trilogy. He was in three different Coen Brothers films. And Hail Caesar was the last one. And it's, you know, these are lampoons of the Flavians. And it's my favorite one because in my new book, it makes a really vivid chapter that is really easy to understand. And people will be able to see, oh man, how Hollywood both destroys us and also ridicules us. And ridicules, you know, people who believe in Christianity. So I wouldn't say it's my favorite Coen Brothers film, but it's one I write about most in the book because it's just very transparent, easy to understand.
Okay, so you mentioned O Brother, Where Art Thou?
Yeah.
And then Hail Caesar was the last one. Was the middle one Burn After Reading then?
No.
Or is it something else?
It's O Brother, Hail Caesar. Gee, I'm having a senior moment here because I don't write about that. It's the other one that Clooney was in. A lot of these actors are kind of, you know, in on the deal and they become, it was the one, it's funny because I can see the film in my mind where Clooney is, it's a modern film. Anyway, I'm sorry, I just forgot.
It's not a big deal if you can't remember.
Yeah,
I thought it was Burn After Reading.
Stuff in my head. I got literally like hundreds and hundreds of films and books and I just can't keep them organized anymore. I can't. The Coen Brothers are valuable because, in general, because they, you know, they use this typology. If you look at the remake of True Grit, you know, you have the character LaBeouf, and they talk about eating him. I mean, the cannibal humor. I mean, here just another one. No Country for Old Men. You know, the character who has the divine voice. You know, who is reaping vengeance and tracking everyone down. He has a nail gun, right? He kills people with a nail gun. Well, if you think of it from the perspective of reversing, you know, the Roman humor, who was nailed, right? Well, Jesus. So this the modern version is killing people with a nail gun. So you can see it's a, you know, it's an example. It's, you know, of like the reversing of the symbolism that the modern oligarchs, you know, find so offensive in the Gospels.
Definitely, man. Well, hey, I do appreciate you hanging out for as long as you did here. Tell people before you go where they can find your work if they want to keep up with it.
Go to caesarsmessiah.com. You can find the books for sale there. The third book, hopefully, will be out within 30 days. I keep reworking parts of it, and so it just keeps getting further and further in the future. But it'll be out shortly. And the documentary is online, just Caesar's Messiah documentary. And it was done by Fritz Heed, a really good director. It's easy to watch, you know, good information, and it's free. So, buy the books because I think the books are useful. And I really do think that understanding the typologic system in the Gospels requires really reading, you know, because that just, you can go through it more slowly than in a film. And so I think it's valuable for people who are interested in, you know, understanding the modern culture to put the time in to really understand how the typology works in the Gospels. I mean, that's self-serving because I get money for selling the book, but I also believe that you really should have this understanding because for one thing, the typology is basically one of the key birthrights of Europeans because, this is something that really we need to understand thoroughly because this has been so destructive for 2,000 years. Once people see how Christianity was created and used, then I think they'll be more alert to, you know, problems we have in the present.
Definitely, man. And I look forward to venturing into the brave new world with you after this next book.
Absolutely. I'll get a copy out to you probably in a couple of weeks. I'll send you the first version. You can check it out and tell me what you think.
Cool, man. I look forward to reading it. Absolutely. So,
okay.
Joe, thanks for your time again, man. I'll talk to you soon.
Thank you, Ryan. Really appreciate it.
pencil.
And there you have it. My thanks again to Joe Atwell. Check him out at CaesarsMessiah.com or postflaviana.org for more on him and his work. I was really hoping Joe was ready to talk about his new book because I don't like treading over ground that's been covered many times before. But Joe made a nice case via email that in order to grok his new book, you have to grok what came before it. So hopefully Joe is interested in coming back to do part two sometime soon. If this is the first time you've heard Joe talk about this material, you're probably not shocked to hear that the New Testament could very well be socio-political propaganda, but the amount of research and detail that Joe goes into positioning the text as a mirror of the Flavian military conquests, well, as they say in my hood, ain't that some shit. And how about the connections to Shakespeare and Catcher in the Rye? I gotta be honest, I grew up as a fan of the Shakespeare plays and sonnets and of Catcher in the Rye. I was the only real fan of Shakespeare in my AP English courses, which always struck me as odd. There was something about the stories and the characters that always resonated with me, and I could never quite put my finger on it. Perhaps this was the reason why. Same for Catcher in the Rye. And both the Shakespeare authorship question and J.D. Salinger's reclusive nature gave these works a hint of mystery that constantly lurked in the background and pulled me back in for numerous revisits. And I'm never one to definitively say, hey, mystery solved, but Joe's work may have, at the least, gotten us a step closer to unmasking those cartoon villains. If you missed the Patreon extension, Joe and I chatted about the phrase fishers of men and catchers of men and the correlation it has to this story. I also thought that may have connected to Catcher in the Rye, so I asked about that too, which led to Joe explaining what the title of the book actually meant. We also chatted about how Joe's research affects other similar ideologies like Islam, Judaism, and even Gnosticism. I also asked Joe about the criticisms of his work and how he addresses them, and finally Joe talked a bit about his concept of God in the wake of this, his interest in Buddhism, weaponized spirituality, and the role that it played in the counterculture. That extension can be heard at patreon.com/occulture, where you can join fine folks like Jeff, Christy, Talam, and Dan in supporting the show. All of them hopped on board the Esoteric Endeavor, which is now the official name for this love-powered locomotive. So if you like what you hear, help keep it on the tracks and help keep it moving forward. We're about 70% of the way to my first goal on there, which will help me upgrade my microphone and recording software. You know, I've been using the same setup for 3 years now, going back to my initial podcast that no one ever heard. So improvements are hopefully on the horizon soon. And speaking of that initial podcast, patrons at all levels of support will be getting access to those lost episodes. They are nowhere to be found online, the feed was shut down, the website deleted, and I had actually thought I lost all the files until now. And wait till you hear how I found them. Of course, you'll have to be on Patreon to hear that story, plus the episodes in full, as they originally appeared a long but short time ago in a galaxy very similar to this one, but also quite different. And one last note on the Patreon, the first Occulture Picture Show has been scheduled, my fancy way of saying movie night. If you're supporting the show at the $10 or $20 levels, mark your ritual calendars for Saturday night, July 14th, 11 p.m. Eastern, 8 p.m. Pacific. We'll be streaming something together online with a full chat capability built in. There's a poll up right now for patrons at those two levels to choose which picture we'll be taking in together. I do hope you'll join us if you can, and if you're interested in supporting the show, if you've been on the fence and have 10 bucks a month to spare, that's a pretty cool reward, I think. New merch is also getting closer too, taking a bit longer than I wanted because I have so much going on and I'm only one man. Well, I'm like half a man, which makes it all the more difficult. Regardless, the dollars are appreciated, the downloads are appreciated, and drop-in reviews are appreciated. Every little bit of time you put into this makes it all the more rewarding for me. I'm having a blast doing this, I've been feeling tons of creative juice flowing through me recently, and there are some exciting things coming not just for this project, but from me in general. And one cool thing about that is if you are supporting me on Patreon, you'll get first looks, first dibs on everything I do, creatively speaking, whether it's for this project or not. I look at it like you're supporting me, and this podcast is just one project that I've undertaken with many, many more to come. Of course, good things take time, and that is hard to come by, so I gotta go make some more of it. So until next time, you've just been initiated into Occulture. I am Ryan Peverly reminding you to love yourself. Think for yourself and question authority.